everyone. My name is Emily, and I am so sorry for that ASMR video. Just kidding, I'm totally not sorry. But in all seriousness, it was something I tried. I didn't really feel 100% comfortable doing it. I think I did okay, considering it was my very first time, and I don't watch ASMR videos. I definitely think I didn't lose myself within the content. I was still able to make jokes and make light of everything, but it's definitely not something I'm going to be doing again. So we're going to be returning to our regularly scheduled smut. So the other week, I really got an itch up my spine to use my very first watercolor palette. And obviously this isn't my very, very, very first one. I'm sure I had Crayola or Rose Art ones before this one. I'm more talking about when I really dipped my foot into the world of watercolors. Now originally, I thought I may have gotten this when I was 14, but judging by some of my older artworks, I actually think I got this palette when I would have been 8, 9, or 10. I've had more than one palette that looked like this, except the other one had little raised bubbles on the plastic cover, so you know that you could mix your colors in those little bubbles. So originally I was gonna make this a cheap art supply challenge, but I really didn't want to go out and spend any kind of money on stuff that I didn't need, especially since I wasn't going to be buying a new watercolor palette. So then I was going to make it a $25 and under art supply quote-unquote challenge with supplies I already had, but then towards the end I used a white gel pen and that would have sent my total over $25, so then I couldn't do that, obviously. So I basically just decided upon using fairly inexpensive products that I already owned, while also using my very first, like, real watercolor palette. And I don't know how I'm gonna fit all that into the title, but I'm gonna find a way. So watercolor chalk cakes like these are typically the lowest of the low quality. They're really usually awful, and I'm not trying to bash cheap art supplies because there are far superior cheap watercolors, like the Prong watercolors. I did a review of those. I will include a link to that review up in the information bar in the top right corner. That all being said, these watercolors are not that bad. They're actually fairly pigmented if you let the water sit on them long enough. Now obviously since they're chalky, the water wants to dry up real quick, so I did have to keep a squirt bottle on hand to spray the part of the palette that I was using. And some colors more than others really needed to be kind of dug at with the brush. And obviously that's not good for your brushes. You really never want to have to do that. If you kind of have to dig to get pigment, the color that you're using is most likely mostly filler. But out of all the crappy watercolor chalk cakes I've ever used, I feel like these are probably the best ones. And they've clearly held up really well over the years, so I can't complain too much. Though I gotta be honest and just add, the most annoying thing about these watercolors is that once they dried, they were chalky on the page as well. So the bottom of my hand after a while was getting discolored with blues and yellow and kind of smearing the chalkiness into other colors, and that was really annoying, but I think all watercolor chalk cakes do that. I don't think you can avoid that if you're using these really, really low-end watercolor cakes. Let's touch on some of the other products I use, starting with the Micron Brush Pen. I've used this before and I keep trying to like it, but I just can't. The problem with brush pens that use a felt tip is that when the felt tip is damaged, which happens very quickly, that's it. The pen's done. It's dead.
It's fucking dead!
Literally RIP. There's nothing you can do to revive it. It went the way of Old Yeller and it was all your fault. You get ballsy and you want some really interesting line width variation because, hello, it's a brush pen. That's what it's there for. So you start really kind of leaning into it, and then before you know it, it's done. The pen was damaged before I even finished the piece, and that caused me to mess up on her face. What was very frustrating too is that this was a brand new pen. I bought three of these thinking that that would last me a while. So two thumbs down on this pen. I will not be repurchasing it. If you want to use a brush pen, I do recommend saving your schmeckles and going out and buying the Pentel pocket brush. They have synthetic little fibers, so it's an actual brush that you're using, and they're quite firm, so it's kind of difficult to damage said fibers. And it's also refillable. Everything all together is a little pricey. The pen, I believe, usually retails between $18 and $21 online and elsewhere, and the refills can go anywhere between, I think, $5 to $12, depending on how many refills you get. But in the end, you'll be saving money because you won't have to keep repurchasing these pens like you would if you were using the Micron brush pens. Now, I love the Micron fine liners. Those are fantastic. I recommend those to the high heavens, and they're affordable. So if you don't want to use a brush pen and you're just happy with fine liners, those are an amazing alternative to something more high-end like the Copic fine liners. Speaking of fine liners, I don't know if I've ever mentioned the Sharpie fine liner pen before, but I freaking love this thing. It's fairly inexpensive. You can usually get them in two packs. You can get them in multiple colors, and it's literally a fine liner. It's like a 0.35 millimeter size fine liner, so it's pretty versatile. Another great thing is that the ink is permanent, so therefore it's waterproof. It does bleed through very thin paper a little bit, so if you're going to use it in your sketchbook, make sure you have at least 75 pound pressed paper. The only problem I have with the Sharpie pen is that it does gray out a bit when you erase over it. Though I do find that to be a trait of all fine liners, I just think it's a little bit more noticeable on the Sharpie pen. The liquid Frisket, or the masking fluid that I used, was just the Blick brand. So far, it has been the only liquid Frisket that I've been able to use that, one, doesn't smell like butthole, and two, doesn't destroy the paper I'm using. The liquid Frisket I used before this was by the Mask Pen brand, and it was awful. Now, because I wanted to stay within the realm of low cost, I only used one paintbrush for this entire painting. That paintbrush was a number 6 Princeton Select. I think these are one of the most inexpensive Princeton Brush Company brushes, and I have zero complaints. I really like this brush. I actually like it better than my number 6 Princeton 4050R. Now, my 4050R actually lost its point after a while, even though I took very, very good care of it. This brush has been around almost the same amount of time and has been used roughly the same amount, because this is my travel brush, and it still managed to maintain its point. I find that it's really worth it if you just spend a little bit of extra money buying maybe 3 of the Princeton Select watercolor brushes, opposed to buying a set of one-size-fits-all brushes, just because there really is no such thing as one-size-fits-all. You really can't have a paintbrush that paints a beautiful oil painting and a beautiful watercolor painting, because they are two very different mediums that require two very different brushes. And last but not least, I just want to give a little shout out to the pen that sent me over the $25 limit, and that is the Signo Uniball pen in white. I ordered them in bulk off of Amazon, so I'm not quite sure how much they are individually. I would guess about $1, $1.25. They're great for adding white back into your painting, and I know a watercolor traditionalist would hunt me down and have my dick for that, but I kind of don't care. If you guys watched my watercolor 101 and that's what made you subscribe to me, you kind of know I'm not a big fan of quote unquote art rules. I mean, some Swiss bitch injected ink into some eggs, put those eggs in her vagina, climbed two ladders and straddled them, and dropped said eggs onto a canvas and called that art. Okay, so if that's art and that's totes my goats cool, then I think we're gonna be okay if we add white back into our watercolor painting. I think we'll be just fine, guys. And I'm not here to criticize or knock egg vagina painting chick. Whatever, it's cool. You know, you do whatever, lady. But if we're not gonna split hairs about that, then I don't think we should be splitting hairs about non-vaginally adding white back into our painting. Cause I'm pretty sure using your vagina to add anything to a painting would not be archival. You know, because that's the thing I worry about when I think about painting with a vagina. I have said vagina way too much in this video. Hey, let's talk about Kiki's delivery service because segue. I decided to paint something that was very nostalgic for me because obviously I am using a literal piece of Emily Artful history to create this artwork. I grew up with the Studio Ghibli films, and Kiki's Delivery Service and My Neighbor Totoro were always my favorites. If I was an extra good little girl, my mom would take me to Blockbuster and let me rent one of these films. If one wasn't there, I would rent the other. Unfortunately, they only had one copy of each, and the other Studio Ghibli film was Grave of the Fireflies, and I distinctly remember watching it, and then at the end of the first act, my mom was like, "Nope. We're not watching this. I'm taking this out." I just love the incredible amount of detail of the whimsy of Kiki's Delivery Service. Every time there was a scene that took place within the bakery, I swear to God, I could smell all of the pastries baking. So I kind of have this rule with myself that if I'm going to watch Kiki's Delivery Service, I need to have gone to a bakery beforehand and loaded up on some sweet, sweet treats. It may also be because I am a big moo-moo. A film gets an A+ from me if it can make me nostalgic of a place I've never been. And Kiki's Delivery Service did that effortlessly. I really felt like I was in this beautiful, quaint little seaside village for 2 hours of my life. For no particular reason, I aged Kiki up just a little bit from 13 to maybe 16, and then unintentionally aged her up again because I screwed up on her face because I felt like I had no control with that felt tip pen at that point, and I kind of messed up her cheekbones, so she looks more like a 28-year-old Kiki. Now, I think at that point, the delivery service would have long lost its novelty and cuteness, and the people around the town would be kind of judgy and being like, "All right, Kiki, come on, when are you gonna get a real job? Let's be serious now."
"But I'm a witch!"
All right, Kiki, let's dial it back a little.
"But Gigi and I need to make these deliveries."
Gigi has been dead for 10 years. Kiki, you need help. Anyway, guys, I think that about wraps up this video. I really hope you enjoyed watching it as much as I enjoyed making it. Thank you guys so much for watching, and don't forget to stay out of trouble. See you guys later.